Whoa, deja vu. We're back. At least I got to rename the fucking stream. So, Doge of Venice, Archstream number 8, Operation Icy Blizzard, which is really what it should have been called. So, and it's me, Ku, and Corvus again. So, we're gonna continue where we left off, as though nothing had actually happened.
Nothing did happen. What are you talking about?
Yeah, nothing happened. I don't know what I'm talking about. Ignore me. All right, so okay, cool. So anyway, Adam Hughes, that's what I was talking about last. He was getting shit because he there was a picture he did of Starfire. And Adam Hughes is known for doing, like, sexy pinup type pieces. They're all really, really good too. His work is awesome. I think that a lot of it comes from haters, but what are you going to do? And they say, oh, this isn't okay because she's a teenager or whatever. And you can't do that. Even despite the fact that, she's been around since the 80s. She's they're thinking about, there's a good chance they're thinking about the Teen Titans cartoon show.
Very likely.
Yeah, very likely. I mean, and what Adam Hughes drew is not the Starfire from the cartoon at all. But then, like, I think most importantly, it's like this. This is how I see it. All right. Hold on, let me make my point with art. Because I fucking hate. This is a weird time we're living in of, like, puritanical fucking bullshit. Okay.
I
Is
yeah, I
this
see that.
how old is this line? How old is that?
How old is it?
Is that underage? Is that underage right now? What I
No.
just did? Is this underage?
That looks like a very skimpy line. I think it might be a little bit underage. You could potentially look at
Now, is it underage yet?
No, it's looking slightly more plumper. There you go.
That line is it underage yet? What was that?
That line has seconds old.
Sexist lines.
Is it underage yet? Is it underage yet?
Stop abusing the lines. What are you doing? Crazy person.
Is it still? No, it's still. It's still not underage. Is it a person? Are we looking at a person yet? My point is, it's just lines on a page. What the fuck?
Like, it'd be interesting because, like, they put a ban on drawing certain things, and they put people in prison. Yeah, people with the skill to draw will just draw what they want to draw anyway.
Yeah.
That's the other thing.
Yeah, it's just.
Unless you chop their hands off, you can't really prevent people from drawing what they want to draw.
Don't give them ideas.
A permanent ban on you, say, like 10 feet away from any paper or pencils.
If I drew a really old woman in, like, in 10 minutes, would she be underage?
You could do like a mix and match of body parts, like an
Yeah,
old
I
woman's
could. I
head,
mean, it's not
and
like
like
I,
a
you know.
like an 18-year-old body with like a Zimmer frame.
It's, I don't know if that's Herbert the pervert or what. Herbert the pervert? On a woman's body, is it an old man, or is it a young girl? I can't tell. And maybe I'll give him gorilla arms. Are we into, what does it mean?
Cover it in hair and call it trans, yeah, trans old person or something. Well, what if your drawing of a younger character identifies as an old character?
What if she identifies as an older person? Mm. As a senior citizen?
Are they going to be, what's it, like, transphobic about somebody who believes they can be anything? I think,
who is attracted it? To this guy, this old guy who said that he was 6 years old. If you like that guy, you're a pedophile.
Yeah, if you're into the six-year-old, the trans six-year-old man, are you a pedophile? That is a good question, one that I will gladly not ever have to answer. There we go. Get your noodly arm ass over here. Muscle on.
Hi there, children. What a strong arm you've got there, child.
Yeah, I'm done. I'm done sharing that because that's not really one I want to draw.
It's like one of the crow creatures from Elder Scrolls.
it's funny about art. You know, once you start representing something, people start applying all kinds of shit to it. Did you guys happen to see the dramatic reading I did of the woman's post about Frank Cho and his work and how people who draw sexy women, it's usually men according to her, that draw sexy women are drawing women that will consent to them and won't say no to being fucked by them and all this like really twisted shit? Did you see that?
No, I haven't seen that. Nope.
Mm. Try that with my female characters.
Yeah.
Killed you in 1 second.
Cool, you're not sharing your screen right now, by the way. Alright, so I gotta do... Somebody said Brian was drawing the vulture from Spider-Man. You know, I didn't even think about that, and yes, you're right. I cannot deny it.
It also kind of looked like one of those creatures from the Dark Crystal.
Yeah, the Skeksis.
Yeah, Skeksis.
She may be a sexy deathclaw.
Icy Blizzard, huh? What if I... Just thinking here. So I just watched this video the other day talking about the differences between these three games that all kind of happen to be coming around the same time. And I'd noticed that they were coming around the same time. And I don't think they're the only ones. Overwatch, Battleborn, and something called Paladins? And the guy was describing like how they're the same and how they're different. Mm-hmm. I thought that the timing on it was really interesting, but I don't think that Battleborn and Overwatch, or Battleborn was trying to rip off Overwatch or whatever. A lot of people are saying that, but I, considering how long it takes to develop a game, I don't really think that that's what was going on. I just think that MOBAs were proving to be really popular, and people were thinking, let's take it to the next level. Plus, Gearbox, the guys who made Battleborn, they were kind of heading in that direction when you look at Borderlands and stuff, and they actually did their game in a different way than Overwatch did. I don't know if you knew that, but Overwatch isn't really a MOBA. It's just a shooter. From what I understand.
It doesn't have anything of MOBA.
Huh?
It doesn't have anything of MOBA.
No. Battleborn is a bit like a MOBA, though, because there are some... I guess some of the play modes involve things like tower defense stuff, but instead of controlling the whole, you know, your hero from, like, the top down, you're just in the first person.
It's like Smite. It's a MOBA in first person.
Yeah, kind of like a Smite type of thing. And Paladins, I believe, was actually developed by the same... Was it them? I think it's the Paladins was developed by the same team that made Smite. But their game sounds awful. I can't remember the name of it. Oh, it's Paladins, yeah. It's like a one of those pay-to-win type of things. Yeah, but free-to-play.
Okay.
But then, like, so are Newgrounds games, so...
Well, what was it? The Elder Scrolls Online tanked pretty hard.
Is it?
Well, I think so, because it made you pay, like, how much is it, like, 40, 60 quid for something like that? Which is, like, I think for dollars, that's $80? Something like that?
Yeah.
To play the game, and it was still pay to win, I think. Well, and subscription, so it was kind of way too much money for it to work.
Yeah, they're called hero shooters, is what they're calling these now. And basically it all comes from, like, Team Fortress 2, obviously, sort of.
Yeah.
Started that.
But what is a complete copy of Team Fortress?
What was that?
It's a complete copy of Team Fortress.
Yeah, absolutely. Overwatch doesn't even pretend not to be. It just does it and sort of takes it to 11 with more characters and stuff like that. And then, in many ways, I guess you could say that when Borderlands came out, they were taking, like, a similar approach where they were like, oh, I like the idea of, you know, that, but we'll put in some RPG elements, we'll put in some, some questing and stuff like that instead of Team Fortress 2, which is just, you know, it's all, like, multiplayer PvP stuff. So, yeah. I was wondering, if anybody's in the chat, because I'm actually really debating whether or not I want to buy Overwatch. And I know that for a lot of people it's like, what? It's like it's a no-brainer, you know, but I'm not really a big Blizzard fan. I didn't get into World of Warcraft, and Diablo 2 was my favorite Diablo, but Diablo 3, I did not like.
Yeah, Diablo 3 was a bit crap. The second one was the best one, though, I think. I didn't play the first one.
Yeah, I played the first one, too. I played the shit out of that. But Diablo 1 is, you know, that's basically just, you know, I don't know. It's basically them just figuring out what it is they have on their hands. Like, they didn't know what it is they had. And Diablo 2 was, at least to me, it seemed like they really knew, like, okay, this is what kind of game this is, you know. We're gonna run with this. Mm-hmm. But Diablo 3, God, I don't know. It was just too easy. And then, I think I played Diablo 3 for a while, and I was like, you know what I realize? All I'm doing is clicking on monsters until they die.
Yeah, I thought it was, like, for, like, a while, because I got it, like, thinking that it was, like, a demo or something, because it was just so easy. Like, I know that sounds kind of odd, but the context of which the game is laid out, it's just really, as you said, you just click and kill, and there's nothing challenging about it at all.
And then, you know, people who are big fans were like, well, you just gotta, you know, you gotta play until, you know, you got to beat it and then play on the harder difficulty levels. And that's when all the good stuff comes out. But, you see, as much as I'm sure that that's true, I don't think that a game should not get engaging until you've invested a whole bunch of time into it. I don't think that's how that should be. I think it should be engaging from the get-go. And maybe, you know, it's just, maybe that's one of the reasons why I'm such a fan of, like, the Souls series, because there is no, you know, I've never had to tell anybody, oh yeah, Dark Souls will get good, you know, or challenging, like, once you've beaten the game one time. No, I mean, for some people that is the case because they're so good at the combat system, but You know, in general, though, you know, this isn't some mindless clicking until you, you know, pick up, get the loot you want. And then, for whatever reason, the you pick up, you end up, like, in Diablo 3 and 2 to an extent also, you end up getting so many drops that you ignore most of it. And so there's just, like, this dungeon that's littered with, like, magic weapons and armor that you don't want. You know, and it's just, I don't know, I didn't get into it. But Diablo 2 is the top, yeah.
A lot of games I found, you sort of start out and it's challenging, but then you get to a point where you become, like, even mildly, like, capable, and you then just don't really have much of a challenge. I found that in some of the Elder Scrolls games, actually, as well.
Mm-hmm.
You get powerful enough to defeat something relatively strong, and just casual monsters don't really pose any kind of challenge to you at all.
That's what I found too. Did you by the way, I saw somebody in the chat mention Doom, and I had to ask, have you guys seen the Polygon video of the guy trying to play Doom?
I haven't yet, no.
Oh my god, dude, it's hilarious. Polygon had released they were doing like a 30 minutes of Doom gameplay. So they had one of their people playing Doom. And this is supposed to be the people who are reviewing our games. So you would expect that they'd be decent at games. Or at the very least, they would get somebody who, you know, knows a bit about the genre of game that they're going to be reviewing. And the person playing Doom for Polygon was fucking abysmal. Like, it looked like they gave their mother the controller to see what would happen. And their mom was like, you know, I could imagine the person at the couch physically moving their arms. You know, like, you ever seen, like, somebody who doesn't play video games, and when they want to move left, their entire body goes to the left, and, like, their hand is, like, all the way. You know, it was like that. I mean, and they were, it was so, so painful to watch. And I'm like, you motherfuckers are the ones that we're paying to do this. And this is what you do. You know, like, what the fuck?
It does make you wonder if Anita would be like that if she did go onto a game.
Oh, no, yeah. She doesn't play her games. No. And she wouldn't play Doom. It's just, you know, you're just like, you're you know, cutting off people's heads and shooting them, and it's gross.
I would probably pay to see that, though.
Yeah.
Just the sheer enjoyment of watching her trying to keep up and being like, oh, the monster's oppressing me. yeah, that would be hilarious. It's not a microaggression, it's a fucking fireball.
Okay, so... just...
That's on me?
Yes! Yeah, this is May from Overwatch. I haven't decided yet. I think I'm probably going to get it. I'm really tempted to, because I do really like the character designs. I haven't figured out which character I like yet. I mean, just based on what they look like, I don't really know.
Discover it when you play it, because I have a few selection of characters that I wanted to play, and when I play it, I play it completely different characters.
Oh, yeah?
I play a lot of Symmetra, and I didn't even know who she was before playing.
Who?
Symmetra.
I don't know. What does she look like? What is she? What is she?
She's the kind of Egyptian, but she's not the one with the heavy armor.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know all the characters yet. I mean, there are a couple that look really cool, that have stood out for me visually, but that doesn't mean that they're the ones I'm going to play as, because I usually end up playing support characters, and then I try to, like, gradually get up to, like, tanking. I actually like tanking in games. And I think that that's how this works, right? There's tank, support, offense, and maybe there's something else, or is that it?
Yeah, but it's kind of weird, because the characters who are supposedly defense characters can kill you in one hit, and the offensive characters have to spend, like, 2 magazines to kill you.
Wait, what?
If you play Tracer, for example, she does very little damage, but then you play a defense character and he can kill you in one hit.
Oh, so like Reinhardt? Isn't he a tank?
A tank, but yeah, he can kill you very quickly.
Yeah, that was the one of the ones I was looking at, was him. I don't really know. I don't know. Like, I like the all of them are really good designs, so I guess there's really no losing in that. Like, there's a... Oh, what's the name of the girl that has a mecha?
Diva.
What's it?
Diva.
Diva, that's right. Is she a tank, too?
She's technically a tank, but the thing is that she doesn't really... She's not really much tanky. Her thing is that when she dies, she goes out of the mech, and she has another life bar.
Oh.
And her feature, her skill is that you throw your mech and explodes and kills everyone.
Oh, so it's like a suicide. Yeah. But it's not really, because you still have one more life. Does she suck after that? Like, you know, you get rid of your mech and suddenly she's, like, just worthless? Or not really?
Well, mostly, yes. Mm-hmm. But you can, if you wait some time, you can have the mech again.
Oh, okay. So you can get it back.
She's the Alu Akbar character.
The Divine Wind character. That is funny. Yeah, and so I was thinking that I may, no pun intended, play May, because I think that she probably, from what I've seen, does a lot of really annoying stuff.
Hmm.
You know, with the ice. What was that?
She's very, very annoying. You can't fight her one-on-one. She wins.
Oh, okay. So is it broken? Is the game... Is there, like, balance problems?
Well, I don't think the game is very balanced, but you can counter the champions with another champion. Like, the thing with her is that if she gets close, she frees you and you can do anything. But you change to the sniper and you kill her from afar.
Yeah. If you're good with the sniper rifle. So, like, Widow...
It's not necessary, because this game has, like, some kind of... Let's say that the hitbox are huge.
Uh-huh.
You completely miss an attack and you kill someone.
Oh.
Oh, wow.
So you're saying that it's forgiving, to put it mildly?
It's like Snipers for Dummies.
Hmm. I think I'm going to change... What I'm going to do is... I'll take this May, and it's not going to be May anymore. I'm going to make it into a Vivian. I'm just going to change the head. We move it up.
She will now be underage.
Oh, no. And so if I'm going to change this person to a Vivian, then That's going to affect the colors. Let me just... People are saying, or, you know, they're saying that one of the things that... These are the identity politicians, not anything else. Well, you know what? I don't like that leg. They're saying that, you know, there's a lot of body positivity in this because of these kind of characters, especially, what was it, the Russian woman?
Yeah.
No one. But they there are people who say, you know, May is like a chubby character or whatever.
I haven't seen her as chubby. She seems normal. I don't know.
I agree. I think she's normal. I just think that people are thinking because she's wearing a big coat, that means that she's representing you know, fat people. No, she's not. Because if you look. Unless Blizzard's going to change it, she might be curvy at best. But if you look at her neck, you can see. Because if this was not, you'd see, like, you know, she wouldn't look like this in the face. So, she's not chubby. She's just wearing a big coat. But you know what? Whatever makes you, whatever floats your boat. Whatever you want to believe. And also, on the other side, Jonathan McIntosh... already wrote something about how Overwatch doesn't have enough variety in their female characters. He said that they all have the same body with different textures and heads. Laughable. Whatever. You can't satisfy these people, Blizzard. Don't try it. Just leave it alone.
I think they learned that lesson with Tracer.
Yeah. Yeah, the Tracer pose.
That's the only thing I have both with the game points, the Tracer pose.
The only what?
You can use game points when you play, you win points.
Oh, okay. So you need to buy the Tracer pose?
So I bought the pose.
Do you see it a lot in the game whilst you're playing?
What?
The poses.
It's at the end of the game.
Ah, okay. So it's not like a taunt.
You can use a pose in game, but it's a different pose.
Ah, okay.
I have there's some friends of mine in a convention right now, and they are telling me in WhatsApp that they are in the cosplay, they are watching the cosplay match, and the one of the judges of the event, one pair is Batman and Harley Quinn. And Harley Quinn, in the act, she hits Batman with her hammer, and one of the judges says, "That's feminist."
Oh, God.
I guess... a woman hitting a man is feminist? Okay.
I mean, at least they're not lying. And of course, people are just like, "Yeah, that sounds right. That's cool. No issues here."
No, they are telling me that the reaction from the people is like, "What the fuck?"
Oh, good. Yeah, I'm starting to think that people are really starting to get sick of it. Well, this woman, go ahead.
Oh no. I was just agreeing.
Oh, yeah. This woman named Grace Randolph, who runs a YouTube channel called, I think it's called Beyond the Trailer. She used to work for Marvel, the Marvel Comics like YouTube channel, and she did a video recently about how Supergirl was being moved to the CW, and she ended up going on a bit of a tangent. Because she was saying, essentially, she was saying, well, I hope the CW, you know, picks it up and does some good with it, and I hope that they stay away from the girl power feminist narrative. And she actually went there, and she said, because, you know, shows like Agent Carter were really big on that narrative, and it hurt the she thinks that's the reason why it hurt the show. And she also had another example, like, she was comparing, I believe it was the new Ghostbusters trailer. And in the new Ghostbusters trailer, or after the new Ghostbusters trailer, you saw, I think there was like a photo with the entire staff that was involved with that film. And it was all these women, and it said, you know, something about girl power on it, right? And she was basically like, you know, I'm just sick of seeing that. I don't think it really helps make the film better. You know, if you want to make a good movie that features women, just make a good movie. Stop with the, you know, with this girl power stuff. And she was basically saying that it's not just her, but a lot of women are sick of it. And I was really glad to hear that. It gave me hope. So I sent a message to Grace, but I don't know that she's going to respond.
It's like all the movies now need to have a girl power scene or something.
Yeah. And it actually makes the stories
have you
worse.
I noticed when I saw the Civil War movie that it's like all the superhero movies now have a scene in which a man is fighting a woman and he says, I don't want to hurt you, and then the woman kicks his ass.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, basically it limits your options. You know. You're hemmed up.
It's a step back because the movies from 10, 20 years ago didn't need to do that. I mean, if a man and a woman have to fight, they fight.
Yeah.
And now it's like the man makes comments like, I don't want to hurt you, you are weak.
Why? Yeah. Yeah, like, what? There, Pride and Prejudice and Zombies? Those are the cringiest trailers, I shit you not. They have to mention that there are women in this movie, I don't know how many fucking times. And it's like, God, I'm glad that's going to be a shit film. Because that is what happens when you try to put feminism in shit. It does not help the final product. I actually had a talk with a guy who was one of our patrons yesterday, and he wanted to talk to me about Yandere. You guys know what Yandere is? I assume that Ku does, but
yeah. No, I haven't heard of it.
Okay, you don't know. So Yandere is basically a character archetype in that's, you know, commonly found in manga and anime, but you could find it in film and stuff too. And it usually involves a person who, usually a female but can be male too, who has incredible affection for a character, and they very much are in love with them, or at least obsessed with them. But it also makes that person psychotic and dangerous. So they'll either hurt or kill people who are considered rivals, you know, romantic rivals, or they'll hurt or kill the character that they're in love with, the object of their desire, because they want to, basically it's one of those, you know, like, if I can't have you, nobody can, kind of thing. And he was asking me about the Yandere archetype, because I guess that feminists don't like that character archetype. And he asked me why, you know, that is. And I said, well, because when it comes to feminism, that women can never be seen as in a negative light under any circumstances ever. And so If it was a male yandere, they're totally fine with it because it paints men as psychotic. That's fine. Provided that he is not going to actually succeed in killing anyone, or, you know, any females, that is. Mm-hmm. But a female one, no. Because that breaks the narrative that women are victims in every circumstance.
Would like movies like Perfect Blue be that kind of genre?
If
you've seen that.
I have, but it's been a while.
Yeah.
I think of Fatal Attraction. If you don't know, Fatal Attraction is a good example. There's a one called Single White Female that's a really good movie that also has it. Although it's got some messed up feminist shit in it too. And then there's like less sort of, I don't know, like those are two of the best examples I can come up with at the top of my head. There's plenty in anime. I'm sure people in the chat are going to throw some.
The most famous is Mirai Nikki.
What is it?
Mirai Nikki.
Oh, I don't know. And what is that from?
A character with pink hair and red eyes. It's a very famous meme in the internet, that character from Mirai Nikki. Have you noticed how now they are making movies about evil characters, evil female characters like Disney characters, and know that they are good?
Yes, that's like Maleficent.
It's like they are trying to change the only bad female characters into good ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're trying to explain their badness by saying that they're good, and they're calling it, you know, essentially trying to make them less one-dimensional. But what they're doing is they're just trying to clean up, you know, any instances of bad female behavior, because they don't want it to exist.
Is that like they try to explain that she was like a good fairy or something like that, and everyone called her Maleficent?
Yeah. Yeah, a really nice fairy named Maleficent. And what made her a bad fairy? The men. A man did it. A man corrupted her. A man took something from her. You know, he tricked her, whatever. It's so fucking terrible. And just lazy. But, you know, I think, like I said, I think people are starting to get sick of it. I hope that that sentiment will continue to grow. Yeah, so. Did you guys hear about Mark Zuckerberg?
No, what about him?
Well, you heard that Facebook has been filtering out trending topics in conservative media.
Yeah, so I heard something.
If like a news story, if like something starts to circulate from Breitbart or something, they will, or at least what they deem to be conservative media. So it could be from alternative media or whatever. It doesn't matter. But essentially, they're making sure that by whatever means they can, that they're controlling the information that, you know, people get. I think that's really fucked up. And then, like, I think Mark Zuckerberg went out. He did a talk where he talked about essentially he did a talk. You know what? I'm gonna look it up. Hold on, because I don't remember exactly. People are calling him Mark Zuckerberg. Let me see if I can find the thing, because I want to get this wrong. So. Tommy Loren did it on her channel. What's wrong? What the fuck? It's on the Blaze. Let's see. While you guys are drawing, let me see what you guys got going on, by the way. What are you doing, Corvus?
This is, is it David Cohn? Chris Grant, I think it was.
Who?
Chris Grant from Polygon.
Oh, okay.
And he's currently...
Looming over the heads of... Who are those people?
Well, this is... because this is a redesign of the old Streets of Rage cover.
Streets of Rage.
Yeah, yeah. These are basically some Badger characters. This is Badger-chan, but wearing, like, the outfit for...
Yeah.
This is Badger-kun and Badger-bishi, who I've...
Nice. Love it. Ku, what are you doing?
I'm doing two things. This is a commission of some kind of girl.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm with Monster Girl stuff too.
Cool. Ursarm. Okay. Let me see if I can find the story I'm thinking about. I'll just go to her on Facebook. Maybe there's a thing. Oops. There was... Oh, crap. All right. I know that Mark Zuckerberg did a talk where he he talked about how essentially he took jabs at Trump and people who want to close their borders, things like that. And Milo and other people, and I hope that no fucking ads start making noise. If they do, I apologize. Oh, yeah, here we go. I'm quoting him right now. Shut up, ad. I hear fearful voices calling for building walls and distancing people, said Zuckerberg, who spoke out against attempts to slow immigration, reduce trade, and cut access to the internet. It takes courage to choose hope over fear, to say that we can build something and make it better than it's ever been before. Previously, Zuckerberg's immigration reform group, FWE.us, created a digital ad campaign slamming Trump and Ted Cruz's anti-immigrant stances. The two GOP frontrunners are consistently advocating for a morally and economically devastating policy of mass deportation. So it sounds like, and this is on CNN, the point is he bashed people, and then when it came to him repressing repressing voices on the right for, you know, like, space on the internet or whatever, like the trending topics to discuss, he said that he was not doing that, and he is open to debating or talking to conservatives about it. And Milo made a video very recently saying that he would like to debate Mark Zuckerberg. So I don't know if you knew that, but Milo's calling him to the mat, so we'll see what happens. But I would say that that just from what I know about what's been going on with Facebook, like, for example, there are certain words you can't use, or, you know, your Facebook gets blocked. I think Kathy Young had, like, recently posted something on her Facebook, and I think she used, I don't even know what word she used. She was talking about male victims of abuse, or, you know, like, domestic violence or something, and her post got taken down, and Facebook told her, you know, that she couldn't do that or whatever. So this sort of stuff is
wait, she couldn't say that males are victims of violence.
She was making a point about domestic violence. She was talking about it. She was speaking to a photograph, which I couldn't look at, so I don't know if the photograph was the problem or not. And she said, look, and it was basically a woman that was filing a false domestic violence claim and using it so that she could get a man, you know, like, imprisoned or beat up by police or whatever, essentially using the arm of the state against this man. Mm-hmm. And she said, does this person look like an abuse victim? And it was I guess there was a photo with it, and she was trying to challenge the notion. And her post got taken down by Facebook.
That's insane.
Yeah. And Facebook, and I mean, Facebook's taken down, like, Milo can't even name his, you know, his tour is called the Dangerous Faggot Tour, right? Mm-hmm. He can't actually use that name. On Facebook, he can't use the word faggot.
Yeah, but there's a difference between like, using a word that may have something offensive. They could get away with that. I can see how they could get away with that. But to silence somebody for stating that somebody is an abuse victim, that's an entirely different level of silence. That's crazy.
Yeah. Well, I think she was trying to actually say that the person in the photo was not a victim, but they were claiming to be a victim. And they were using that to essentially victimize somebody else. Because if you're a man who does not abuse his spouse, and your spouse calls the cops and says that you did, when the cops come, there's a good chance that you're going to be the one that's going to taste,
yes,
you know, abuse, because they're going to come thinking that you're a wife beater.
In Spain, it's 100% chance.
Oh, really?
It's by law. The laws we have state that if there is a domestic violence call, the man must go to jail.
See?
Yeah.
I have no words. I don't even know what to say to that.
Yeah.
We have very fucked up laws.
I think that's kind of creeping in everywhere, though.
Or where it's sort of realizing it.
Where it's extreme on one side. Sorry, go on.
People talk much about Sweden, but we have harder laws than them.
That's insane, bro. I think that's good. Okay. I think I'll ink this in now. Somebody asked, is that Miss Marvel? What do you mean, is that Miss Marvel? I'm going to get a refill from my coffee pot. Okay, okay. I'll be right back.
So how long has that law been established for?
More than 10 years ago.
Yes.
It's called the in English integral law for gender violence.
Okay.
And it has already been deemed unconstitutional by the European Council. But it's the same. No one is trying to take that law down.
The strange thing is, it seems. It seems very much like you have extreme laws on one side or the other. It seems to me that it's either very pro-female or very anti-female, but in extreme levels. And I don't know. It seems where, you know, that there may actually be a need to try to help women. It seems that feminists don't seem to give really much of a shit about those people, you know, which is just crazy.
What was that now? I missed it.
Oh, I was just talking, I was just saying that there seem to be extremes of law for and against women in the world in different places, and, you know, they're protected in the opposite ways, you know, people who already have all the privileges that men do are focusing on getting more privileges, and people like women who are actually being oppressed are being quite often ignored by the people who have the power to change things, and it's usually women who advocate for fixing those problems who are the most silent in those areas.
Yeah. Yeah, it does seem like that, but then, I don't know, like, I've gotten to the point now where if I hear that, there is some, you know, like, there's a part of the world where women are especially sort of oppressed, I become a little bit distrustful, and the way that I do it is the way I handle it or deal with it is I just look to see, you know, what it's like for men there so that I can put it in better, in more complete context. Because it might be shittier for women compared to women everywhere else, but it might just be shittier for everybody compared to everywhere else, too.
That's
so it's important to look at that. Because when you just view it through that lens of, like, you know, the lens of women suffering, it's easy to it's easy to forget, you know, what you're looking
at. So. It's easy to get caught up in the narrative they spin.
Yeah, essentially.
Yeah, okay. I can definitely see that.
Oh, I better put this on top so I can see what the fuck I'm doing. I'm gonna do Vivian as May, but with Gamergate colors. Let's see how that goes. Because I was thinking about making her like Mr. Freeze. But then I realized that the timing and everything is too good, plus it's got the word, what is it, Blizzard in it? So, you know, it's like, why wouldn't we do that? So have you guys seen Civil War yet?
No, but I'm looking forward to seeing it.
Coup?
Yes.
What did you think?
Another superhero movie. Not very interesting. But I have read the comic, so I'm extremely biased.
Oh, right. Yeah, well, there was no way it was going to be as good as the book. I read the book, too.
Yeah, but it was not going to be like the comic, but they, like, fucked up the entire concept. Like, there is not two sides. It's like the side of Captain America, and that's it.
Oh, yeah, well, yeah, I can see what you're saying. That's why, you know, when they announced it, I even said they shouldn't call it Civil War. They shouldn't have named it something different. Because it's gonna do that to people. It's gonna, you know, create expectations. And it wasn't trying to be like the series, so that was just a waste of... I don't think that was a good idea. I get it. Because it had a couple of callbacks, like some of the phrasing. You know what? And I'm not okay. Well, maybe I shouldn't spoil it because Corvus is here. I won't spoil it.
That's fine. You can say. I don't mind.
It's not a huge thing. It's a little thing. But one of the best bits. It's like my favorite Captain America quote. Let me see if I can find it. Okay, and it's from the comics. I'm just gonna look it up here. Hold on.
The one of the you move.
Yes. I just gotta read it because it's so good. Captain America quotes. Okay. Let's see if I can find it. Okay, I did find it, but it's gonna take a second for my thing to fucking load it up. Oh, come on. Christ. All right, we'll do it this way. Okay. Doesn't matter what the press says. Doesn't matter what the politicians of the mob say. Doesn't matter if the whole country decides that something is wrong, if something is right. It doesn't matter if the whole country decides that something is wrong is actually something that's right. This nation was founded on one principle above all else, the requirement that we stand up for what we believe, no matter the odds or the consequences. When the mob and the press and the whole world tell you to move, your job is to plant yourself like a tree by the river of truth and tell the whole world, no, you move. And that's an epic Captain America quote. And in the film, he doesn't get... They kind of butcher it a little bit. They don't do the whole thing, which I'm like kind of bummed out by because it's really good. They leave out the press, which I think is in the media. They leave that out when they say, well, it doesn't matter what the press or the media says. They leave that part out of it. But so first off, they kind of butcher the quote a little bit, which bugs me because it's really great. But the part that's really annoying is that it's not Captain America's quote. It's Peggy Carter's quote. Hmm. So Peggy Carter is the one that said it, and... It sounds like, you know, because they didn't like outright say it, but they allude to the you know, the idea that Peggy Carter was more qualified to make that quote based on the fact that she was a woman coming up in that era. Because they say, oh, well, you know, she was facing her own problems, you know, and if you watch Agent Carter,
it was worse than that. It's one of the worst lines of the entire movie when Peggy's out there. The line, I think it was, she was a woman in a year when no one wanted to see a woman succeed or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. And it was like, why are we talking about this right now? You know, and why are you guys butchering this quote? That actually, I mean, it's not something that applies to gender. It's a universal principle. And why are you leaving out the media? Like those are little things, because I still really liked Civil War. I thought it was really great. But That stuff really bugged me, though. You know, those little things they did. And I don't think it's an accident, because it wouldn't have taken that long for her to deliver that line, considering how long to deliver the entire quote. And it wouldn't have been, I get it, like, what they were trying to do is, it was, you know, right after this big decision, and maybe it was supposed to convince Captain America or something in some way, like she was basically speaking to him from beyond the grave with a bit of wisdom, but Captain America doesn't need wisdom from beyond the grave. He's already the shit. Like, what are you talking about? But yeah. What was that?
I said it sounds very interesting. I look forward to seeing what, like,
yeah, that's good.
Context of that.
Yeah, I'm not giving away any spoilers, Mystic Knight. It's fine. You should definitely watch it. That's all I'm going to say. It's not really a big spoiler, but that is, it's just a quote that Sharon Carter, Agent 13, says in the film when she's quoting her aunt. And that's all I'm going to say. So.
Bruce Willis dies.
I'm sorry, what I actually heard was Bruce Willis dies.
Yeah.
Bruce Willis was dead the entire time. It turned out that the village was actually in the modern world. You remember that movie, The Village?
Yeah. The girl who has to go outside of the village. Is that one? Yeah. Yeah.
I remember when that trailer came out. I was really just done with M. Night Shyamalan.
I thought the trailer looked really, really good. It's just a shame that the film was crap.
Yeah. I actually predicted. I never saw it. I never watched The Village.
Oh, you never watched it? Okay.
No, I never watched it. Because I already knew, I predicted it. When I saw the trailer, I predicted what was the twist. Because by that time, you were looking for the twist in his movies. So I was like, oh, well, the twist is that it's actually not taking place in the past. And, you know, the scary stuff outside is just the real world. Sure enough, that's what it was, more or less. I didn't watch the movie, so I don't know for sure. I didn't confirm it.
Yeah, you pretty much hit the nail on the head.
Yeah. Yeah, it was garbage. do you guys think that Ghost in the Shell is going to be any good?
No.
I don't know. I'm always hopeful, although I remember you said, people said that they weren't really fans of Naruto, but for the chat, if they are at all, I have some potentially bad news. I have heard that the guy who made Dragon Ball Z Evolution is going to make a live-action Naruto film. So, sad days.
Have you seen the guy who did the Assassin's Creed movie?
Yeah.
Has talked about the movie, and he has said, I think the movie it's gonna be good because someone has to do it right sometimes. Like, all the movies about video games are bad, and he knows it.
Yeah. I don't, you know what, I'm at the point now where video games don't need to be made into movies. I don't care if they never do it. Because I think that you're running into a challenge when you adapt video games to movies, because you're taking something that is interactive on a level beyond film, where you're just sort of a passive viewer, and now you're taking an element out of it and focusing on the narrative in order to try to tell a story. And sometimes a narrative, even if the game is really good, the narrative, when you really think about it, it's not that awesome, you know? Yeah. So you don't have a lot to work with.
Well, I think it can be done, but I think that the person who makes it needs to actually be a fan. And I mean, like, somebody who really knows, is a fan of what it is at its core.
Hmm. There are games that you just need to put the cinematics all together and you have a movie, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like Metal Gear.
they could just...
You won't be able to follow it, but...
Oh my god, Metal Gear Solid would be an amazing movie. If they did it right.
I don't know. I mean, it would be convoluted as fuck. Good, though, but I guess. But, I mean, considering the track record, again, I don't see how that's possible.
Sure.
I also don't understand why people want live action versions of anime or cartoons. I don't see how that improves it anyway. You could just watch the anime. Like, there is almost no way in hell that an anime adaptation of or a live action version of an anime is actually going to be better than the original, because it won't have.
Yeah.
There was something about the original that got people's interest in the first place. So maybe. How could something come out and something that's going to come out of a niche market, like a smaller group of people that have a devoted fan base, and you're going to expand it to try to like get a mainstream audience and make it attractive to them without alienating the original audience in some way? It's an impossible task. Now, maybe there are people that are just doing it for the challenge. But I think that there are people who just think it's bankable and that they can just get away with it. And I also think that there are people who are nostalgia fags and they think that, you know, by doing this, it's actually going to be some kind of improvement. Like, somehow making it a real movie, which is what a lot of people would call it, is better, or it elevates the product outside of what it when it was an anime film. I mean, even, like, and I've said this on other shows, even Japan can't do it. Like, Japan can't adapt their own shit, you know, without it being shit. So, why do we think we can do it? So, I mean, we can't even take Japanese live-action movies and do them as better movies. How many times have we tried to do Godzilla, and we can't do it, you know?
I don't know. I thought is it 1999 or 2000? That Godzilla wasn't too bad. I mean, it was cheesy as fuck, but...
Oh, I didn't see that one. I remember the Roland Emmerich Godzilla, which was god-awful. You're not talking about that, are you?
I don't think so. Wait, the one where he's running down the dock?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
And I kind of like that one.
Oh, God. There's a scene with raptor, like baby Godzillas, but they're like basically raptors.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know.
Out of the streaming.
You're not allowed back on the show.
No.
The Japanese actually did a joke about that, and they included that Godzilla in the official timeline.
Oh yeah, Godzilla versus everybody.
No, the thing they did is. In the next Godzilla movie, they said, "Hey, did you know that a monster appeared in the United States?" Yeah, and the Americans think it's Godzilla, but it's not.
Oh yeah, they made a movie where Godzilla fought every monster in Japan, like every monster ever, I believe, and one of them was
Godzilla. Yeah,
like that Godzilla, and he killed him like. Or she killed him, or whatever. Killed him super fast.
Final Wars.
Yeah, it was Godzilla Final Wars. That I thought that was pretty fucking sweet.
Hmm. And they're doing a new one.
A new what? Final Wars.
A new Godzilla.
Japan or?
Japan.
Good. Yeah.
The one I want to see is the Guy King movie, the live action Guy King movie.
The which?
Guy King.
Oh, okay.
The giant robot with the horns.
Yeah, I remember that.
They did a trailer about 5 or 6 years ago, and the trailer is fucking epic. The designs are awesome.
Oh man, that is cool. I remember that from like when I was little. That's old, isn't it?
Yeah, very old. It's Mazinger age.
I used to. It was a mecha with horns. They were yellow.
Hmm.
I think. I'm gonna look it up. I think I had the toy of that. It was like a giant hollow plastic thing that launched missiles, spring-loaded missiles. It's Guy King, right? Hmm. Yes, yes. It has a face on the chest. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I used to have that. That figure. It was like a oversized toy.
If you look in YouTube, there's the trailer. It's a minute long only, and it's epic.
I will. I did not know that. Love those tiny girls in the box. I don't know what that means. Still looking for the Boba Fett with the ejectable rocket. I don't know that ever existed. Honestly, I don't even... like. I know that they added it on in Clone Wars. They had Jango Fett launch the missile, but I don't know that it was actually supposed to be a missile. I think that, you know, kids just wanted it to be one.
That reminds me of the Little Warriors movie, I think it was called. The movie about the toys with so advanced that they are alive.
Small Soldiers.
Oh, yeah, Small Soldiers.
I remember that. Tommy Lee Jones was the voice of the leader. And the humans were the bad ones, and the creatures were the good ones, or whatever.
It was an interesting movie for a kids' movie.
It was. It was pretty cool actually.
I like the end because they do things like in a logical way, like the warriors, the archer and all these warriors, they say we are programmed to lose, and in the end they lose because they are programmed to lose.
Hmm. That's true. Let's see. They were prototypes, never released into the market. Well, yeah. I got back into Destiny. I hadn't touched it in a while.
You're already playing Destiny?
Yeah, I played it like way back when it first came out because I got caught up in the hype storm. And I was playing it with a... What?
Sorry, I was going to say, I played it on Xbox.
Oh, I play it on PS4.
Civil War. And...
What?
Civil War.
I don't know. I Xbox. No wonder you like Godzilla.
fuck you. Hey, I gave that up a long time ago.
The Xbox?
Yeah.
Why?
Because it sucks.
You bought the Xbox One.
It was more of a gift.
Okay. What do you mean by more of a gift? Like you were asking for it, and then you were
doing No. It was left by a friend who went off to America.
Okay. Oh yeah. All right. Well, anyway, I hope you're happy with it. To be honest.
Oh yeah, it's pretty good.
But it's not. I had the first Xbox. Back in the, back when it was like Xbox versus PS4 or whatever.
Yeah.
But I didn't play a lot of games on it, and I also wasn't really a fan of what they were doing in terms of like their library. So I don't think that the PlayStation is better per se, but I like the library more. It's like it's my taste, you know. So yeah. That's my thing. It's like.
Well,
that's what's important.
Yeah, really.
Ever since I got on Steam, I haven't really touched any consoles.
The Chinese have made another console, so we are all doomed.
The Chinese have made a console?
Yeah, they have made a copy of the Xbox.
Oh my god. That's funny. Is it going to run all of their free-to-play MMOs? Because it seems like that's all China makes. That's another thing. I'm kind of done with MMORPGs. I think the time sink is just not of interest to me. I'm still subscribed to Champions Online. Because I like the character creation stuff, but I'm not going to get into any other ones. I don't think that they're...
Are you a customization whore?
Oh, yeah. I love customization.
Yep, I'm the same. Yeah.
When I got back into Destiny, I made Donald Trump.
Oh, God.
He's the Fallen King.
What?
He's the Fallen King.
Yes. because I happen to be digging around with the character creation, and I was like, holy shit, this guy looks like Trump. So I made his hair was white originally, and then I said, well, I'm going to make his hair, blonde, and I'm going to make his skin orange and play him, see who I can trigger.
Have you seen someone did a very good manga drawing of Donald Trump with a stand?
Yes.
The stand is the wall.
The wall. Zawaldo. But yes, I have seen that. It's pretty epic. Right. Let's see what people are saying here. Yeah, when I one of the things that I guess people who have been really, really into Destiny though complain about, like my brother, he's like really into it. I guess when the Taken King came out, if you buy the Taken King, is that what it's called? Yeah, the Taken King expansion, you get an item that you can give to your character and immediately start at level 25. So you basically bypass everything. And you also get, I guess the loot is so much better now and more frequent drops of it. So people who worked really hard to get stuff are seeing people who just got it and they're, like, getting all the cool shit, for no effort at all. And it's pissing them off. I think it's pretty funny. Not surprising, though.
That happens a lot in MMO.
Yeah. Oh, well, what to tell ya? Let's see, I'll use this. The Wii was Kang's expansion, yes. That's what we should call it. The Taken Kangs. Go for a bit longer, like another 20 minutes, since the stream died and I had to start over. The free update came out 2 weeks ago. What free update are you talking about, Shigeru Green? Who in the chat hopes the Ghostbusters is a good movie? And who hopes it's awful so that they never try that shit again? What about you guys?
I'm kind of hoping it would be funny. I don't really, I'm not really that invested in whether or not it's feminist propaganda, but I'm kind of hoping. I know the large chick. I forget her name. She can be quite funny sometimes.
I laughed at her. Oh, Melissa McCarthy.
I think so. Yeah.
She's alright. I liked her in Bridesmaids, and I thought she was quite hilarious. But she hasn't really done it for me since, so I don't know if it's, I don't know. I don't know if it's because she just happened to get lucky, or maybe she was just unlucky in the other stuff I saw her in, or what.
I guess only time will tell, really.
Yeah. Let's do the bandana. Bandana Fafana. This is what it is when you live in the hood.
I noticed we do spend a lot of time drawing, and of course, talking about stuff, but I don't think we have much talked about actually drawing.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, I did when I do usually talk a bit about that. Mm-hmm. We haven't done it today, though. Let's see. Oh, you know what? Oh, no, I did draw the Herbert thing on this one. What? No, because I'm like, was that on the other stream? Because that's gone forever. No, it's in this one. So, Corvus, you're using Photoshop, right?
Yeah, CC.
And when you do all that that blending, I haven't been looking at how you do it. Are you using a tool, or are you simply overlaying brush on top of brush on top of brush?
I use the smudge tool. I've got about 3 different layers of light and shadow.
Mm-hmm.
And I use the, for the lighter areas, I use the smudge tool to just, like, shape it around the face.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if I were to speed up my drawings, how would you, what advice would you give me for, because I've noticed that when I draw, my pictures are always, like, the less complete of everyone else's when I do my pictures. So, I was wondering, like, what would you say would be a good practice in order to speed up
drawing? Oh, I don't know. I always feel like I haven't gotten a lot done.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, we're like 10 minutes to go, and like all I have is the, you know, Vivian's head, like flat with partial flat colors. So I don't know. I guess it depends on the amount of detail you want to put in. So maybe it's comes down to like your sort of your process and your step-by-step process in terms of how you move from one point to the next point, right? So perhaps you're dealing with the shading right now, but you haven't. Are you going to apply any like skin tones or anything, or is that color the color you want for that?
For this particular character, this is the color that I want.
Yeah, because you want it to be kind of pushed back, right?
Yeah.
And it sort of matches the color that were used on the Streets of Rage.
Exactly. That's what I'm kind of going for.
Yeah. So what you could do is put all the flats down on all the characters and come back and do like a level of tone so that people who are watching We'll see what you're doing, what your plan is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a good idea.
So, and then, you know, that way you're not spending, like, the entire stream just doing that one face. Mm-hmm. That would be one way to do it. But it really, like, I don't want to break your flow, because if that's the way you work, you know?
No, I don't work any particular way. It's kind of, I even change up the way that I do things depending on what picture it is as well. I don't have necessarily a specific process in which I go through the pictures and the art form, but I guess it depends. I come at pictures differently depending on what the end process, what the end outcome needs to be.
I see.
That might be strange for most artists who have like a process, but I don't know, it's just the way it's worked for me so far. Well, this is current. I did like a SketchUp background, and this is kind of what it looks like so far. So,
looks good. Are you gonna draw the guy's body, or is that not how it was?
No. It's just the head and the hands. Of course, like I'm gonna mess around with what's in the foreground, what's in the background, and everything. But yeah, the character was just a head, hands that are kind of like looming over a city, and like there was a separate title that had just the characters that were like in fighting poses. So I thought I'd combine the two and just make it look interesting.
Yeah. Well, it looks good. Are you going to put any? Because I know that the way that the original illustration was done, it left space for. I'm assuming it left space for like the logo to go in.
Yes, I'm gonna make a parody logo.
Okay, so you're gonna put one in there. All right. So basically, the idea is to make it match as much as possible.
Yeah. I guess pretty much.
Well, yeah. I mean, I guess if you just do the flats, it should be good.
Not looking on the flats here.
Somebody told me that the hip is off.
Hip is off? On my picture? Or?
No, on mine.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'll do is...
Seems okay.
I'll zoom out and look at it. She's supposed to be leaning forward, and then...
Are they referring to the thigh as her leg being sort of pulled out, or what?
Unless the hip is like right here, that's where the hip is at. So it's like, there's the hip, here and here, and then the leg goes that way and that way, and she's leaning forward like this. And then, like, here's the shoulder, and it goes there. And it's, like, foreshortened. There's a fist right here. So, I don't know. I mean, I'll put some more color in. Maybe it'll look more clear. I'm not assuming that I'm right, but I do think it's important to see it as it should appear before, we make any... declarations on that. Okay. Oh, Vivian is not underage. I don't think. I have decided for the purposes of this
arrest him
piece of art. Vivian is a full-on adult and has agency all her own.
She's a 92-year-old child.
Yes. Trapped in a two-dimensional drawing, in the body of a two-dimensional piece of artwork, who I am drawing for the sole purpose of I want to create a woman that can't say no to me, as the female who wrote that beautiful and well thought out piece of literature that I got to read. Twisted fucking people, man.
Well, they're perfectly fine with protecting pedophiles. They're just very selective with who they are protecting, I guess. from what I understand.
Yes, if you're the right kind of pedophile, then, you know, you're safe. You're safe.
If it endangers real children, it's perfectly acceptable.
Yeah.
Fucking crazy.
You know, I don't know. It's like Hannah said, I can't remember her name, but there was a feminist who had a book of photographs of young boys, and it was called Beautiful Boy. And it was basically all like, it was pretty fucking messed up.
Yeah.
Monster Girls. Jermaine Greer, thank you. Privileged checker. And that was photography. Not drawings. Photography. And you can find it on Wikipedia. And if somebody shared like excerpts from it on Facebook, Mark Zuckerberg probably would not get it removed. Mark Zuckerberg.
It's very Twilight-ish, like how the current, as you said, the strange way that we live in these days, like how things have kind of unfolded over the past few decades.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, what do you mean? Strange. Well, purely for like what the Honey Badger's advocating for and everything else, like the necessity for it. Even for me now, I kind of find it quite abstract that the world has fallen into this kind of very delusional state. And the people who, you know, are trying to defend equal rights are the ones who are being spat on.
Yeah, dude, it's like, it's surreal. It's like I live in Bizarro World. It's Bernstein Bears.
Yeah.
It's just backwards. It feels backwards, but it may not be. And I'm saying, like, I say that fully aware that, you know, like, I could have been more wrong in the past. Mm-hmm. I hope that's the case. Because, you know, sometimes you don't know, like, you know, how wrong you might be about something until after the thing has, like, you know, it's become, like, really clear. Mm-hmm. So I'm always second-guessing myself about stuff. I think that's important, you know, because you don't know what you're blindly, like, if you might be blindly following something that is incorrect. So to constantly challenge it is important, but a lot of people don't do that these days.
I know it's a Star Wars reference, but I like the proverb of only the Sith deal in absolutes, because this is kind of like, okay, well, things need to be like open to question, and it's like Milo says that, you know, the best thing you can do is shine light on the problems.
Mm-hmm.
Let crappy arguments be smooted by decent ones, I guess.
You know, the saying only Sith deals in absolutes is in and of itself is an absolute.
That's true. I didn't think about that.
So I hope that was my first thought when I was watching the film, and Obi-Wan says that. He says, only a Sith deals in absolutes. And I was like, wait, you just did, just now. You're a Sith!
Well, also, I guess that's a very good point, actually, because that's the kind of stance that SJWs take, I suppose, because they are so entrenched with feeling like they are correct that they feel like they are like the Jedi, I guess. continue the metaphor, you know, protecting people from the evil Sith.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess they don't even realize the kind of, like, the amount of crap that they deal with what they're saying. I don't know. I'm waffling there.
Wait, repeat that?
I can't be bothered today. It's early. Basically, I'm saying that SJWs don't necessarily see what they do, so in essence, they do the same sort of thing as the Jedi does. Yeah,
lack of self-awareness is
a
common thing, and that well, because the cost, like, of realizing that you might be wrong is so high, they don't, like, to them, they can't do it, man. Well,
that's the same thing for any religion that ends up being wrong. You know,
mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that any are or not. I'm not going in that kind of area. But for if there was an ultimate thing that says, "Oh, we are correct and this is how it should be," then those people who have been advocating for, you know, their religion the entire time, you know, they've got centuries of people sacrificing themselves and all sorts of crazy crap that they have to turn around and be like, we may have been slightly incorrect in our first initial thought, you know? And I think that kind of backpedaling, I think their egos are, like, far too large for what they've sacrificed, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So then it becomes like just a constant, forever double down.
Yep, that's they're gonna double down for sure. Mm. That is the MO of SJW. Put this on top. People are talking about porn in the chat. I feel left out.
What is the topic on the porn?
I don't know. I just saw someone saying. Wait, what does it say? Because I don't know what it is. I saw some 4chan post about some guy whose mom walked in on him fapping to Guro. I don't know what Guro is, though.
I've heard the word before.
It's when something or someone devours a woman.
What?
Devours a woman?
Yeah, it's like a monster engulfs a woman or someone eats another person or things like that.
So is that like kind of a war, isn't it? Like, kind of like war?
What?
War. It's essentially what you just described, I think.
War, yes.
Yeah.
So Guro and Vor are the same thing?
I don't know. It kind of sounds like it. The chat will probably know.
No, that's Vor. Gore! Oh, they meant to say Gore. So Gore is not Guro, but Gore. I guess they misspelled it. So Gore is another kind of hentai, I suppose? Perhaps one that deals with violence? Do you guys think that, like, say we had a guest like Milo on, theoretically. Milo might say that a person who's into gore has some kind of, they have some trauma that they need to deal with. And then, because, you know, people try to define what is considered normal and, you know, what is not. Do you guys think that it is normal to be into that, or do you think that indeed might be coming from someplace else that needs to be addressed in that person's life? I'm not passing judgment. I'm just asking. Because I honestly don't know. It's not what floats my boat.
I think that we all come from a place where we have to, where we learn things as we grow older. And of course, everyone has crap they need there that they deal with. So it's like, you know, the trope of the Japanese man coming back from like the office job and then, I don't know, getting on his Pikachu suit with a whip. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if it's considered normal or not. I'm not a psychologist, but I would certainly say that. There's definitely a mixture between them, and maybe that something that they maybe they need to work through it. Maybe they don't need to work through it, and that's how they ground themselves. And if that's what makes them happy, then I suppose as long as it's not really harming anyone.
Yeah, you see that.
But I certainly wouldn't call them, well, depending on what it is, I certainly wouldn't call them like sick or twisted or anything. It's very different. People have different mentalities, but just because they have things that may not be what other people are used to, you know, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's good or bad. It's entirely up to their mode of thinking.
Is a non-practicing pedophile sick? Like, they don't actually do anything to children, well, but the desire is there.
In all technicality, I would say yes, they are sick, but because, I mean, if it's still there, you know, the sickness is still there regardless of whether they're acting upon it or not, but there's a very big difference between somebody who, you know, who should be brought to justice for something they've done,
absolutely,
something they've acted upon, and you know, whether or not they've done it. So my opinion is that yes, they are sick, but I don't think as long as they don't act on impulse and they aren't fucking stupid, you know, they should be okay, I guess.
Well, I'm just wondering because, you know, there's discussion around, like, when something is a fetish and it's not really indicative of something that might be troubling that person, and then there are some things that, you know, we might call fetishes that some people might say are indicative of something that's a problem for that, you know, for those people. And so I guess, do we simply... There may not be a simple black and white answer, but do we simply say all fetishes are equally okay and none of them are weirder than others?
Or I don't think so.
What?
So I don't think so. Sorry, I did cut you off though. But go
on. No. I was saying, or do we say, no, because, you know, there are people who they're just into like stuff that I don't understand at all, a lot of it. But I don't judge them for it. I mean, I'm, you know, whatever, oh, yeah, you know. But so, yeah, it's like one of those, do we say that it's all okay, or do we say that there's a line, and if there is a line, where is it? You know, like that, because that's really hard to pin down, to, you know.
I would personally say that to pin down some kind of, you know, each I guess, alternative lifestyle, you could call it, to be nice, you know, they have different connotations psychologically. Somebody who might have a thing for their parent, or, you know, or younger children, or older people, whatever. You know, it doesn't matter. Well, it what matters is, you know, whether or not that kind of psychological link is something that could potentially bring them down the path to something dangerous, or, you know, breaking the law. I think was it David Jaffe in that interview said, you know, anyone could think of anything. You know, doing anything could bring somebody down a path to lead them anywhere. It's not what you know, it's not what could potentially be. You can't just label somebody something they haven't done. But at the same time, you know, to be aware that somebody could potentially be, I don't know, a school shooter or something, because they've got like the movie Psycho, you know, an unhealthy relationship with their mother.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's just very psychological, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm just thinking about. I don't get foot fetishes either, Ken. Ken said in the chat, foot fetishes, I don't get it. And I'm like, I don't either. I don't. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. I just don't, you know, it's just not for me. That doesn't get my wheels turning.
I do actually happen to know somebody who likes foot fetish, but...
Oh, I think as far as fetishes go, it's a fairly benign and common one.
Yeah, yeah.
I think Quentin Tarantino has one. I'm fairly certain. He hasn't said it.
He does.
Yeah, you could see it in his movies, right?
Yeah.
And I'm reminded. I thought about that because I think the last Shoe on Head video, she said that she's gotten comments from people asking, you know, to show her feet on camera. And she's like, I'm not going to do that, foot fags. You know?
Okay.
But, yeah, I don't know. It's just not my thing. So.
Oh, yes, sir.
Let me just put some purple in here.
But I think where the problems lie is that people who don't understand other... I mean, you can kind of understand psychologically or, you know, scientifically where somebody would acquire their fetish from. So you can kind of understand from their point of view why they would be interested in what they're interested in. You know, it could be an event that happened to them when they were younger or something like that. They might have... stumbled across something that they ended up finding out that they enjoyed, and you know, that could end up possibly being how they start acquire that fetish. But I lost my train of thought now. I was trying to go doodling.
You're the spaghetti is coming out.
I will stop my face speaking.
Sorry, I just like to think about this kind of shit. Just out of curiosity, it fascinates me.
Yeah, same.
Just understanding people better, basically. So, I knew a girl who I dated that was into some pretty fucking kinky shit, and but she also had a lot of problems, like she was on meds and stuff. But I don't think that everyone who's into kinky shit is on meds.
No, certainly not. But there is definitely a correlation. I would definitely say that mentally there is a correlation between, you know, something that they like and something that's happened.
Raymond Duncan says alcoholism is linked to coprophilia. Could you tell me what coprophilia is?
Coprophilia?
Eating shit.
What?
It's, I don't remember if it's eating shit or fucking shit.
Eating shit.
Wait, yeah. What?
Eating shit. Alcoholism is linked to coprophilia. It's a poop fetish.
How the hell is that? I can't see the correlation between those two.
Alcohol, I mean, I drink, but I certainly don't think about eating shit. But maybe people who eat a lot of shit are also alcoholics. You need to chase that shit down with a bit of rum or whiskey. I think that's probably... It's just that it makes a good chaser. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe alcohol just is a good chaser for fucking corn diarrhea.
Shaken, not stirred.
Oh my god. Not all alcoholics are coprophiliacs. No, but maybe a lot of coprophiliacs are alcoholics. Well, if you drink Foster's. All right.
Australian piss water.
It's Australian for piss water. I think I'm going to call the stream because I think it went on for a bit. So.
Okay, sorry.
But let me see where you guys are at. This is just, like, not even the flat colors are finished on my Vivian May or Mavian. I don't know what I'm going to call it. But this is basically as far as I got with it. So it's just got the sketch lines down. I'll probably put some... Maybe I'll pick it up in the next stream and keep adding lines to it. I think it'd be fun if I can. So let me see where Ku is at. This is your monster girl. Oh, look at that. Oh shit, can't show that on camera. We're gonna get the video removed. It's the monster girl.
I have a lot of things drawings in my and I did this position too.
I like that.
That's cool.
Don't zoom in on the clam. I don't want to lose the video. I don't know that it's going to get reported. Please don't report this, guys. You can't really.
I said it now. They're going to do it.
No, they're not going to. Quim alert. Moose knuckles. Okay, and Corvus looks good. Oh yeah, see, I like that. Yeah. I like the colors. Here's another thing too. I wanted to say this to Eduardo, but he never made it in the stream. Let me see. He did a drawing of Badger Chan, and I really liked what he was doing. Yeah, it looks good. It's gonna look great. And I want to make a thing about Badger Chan. This is important. If you're going to draw a Badger Chan, there is a small detail that a lot of people overlook, they don't see, that I put in on purpose. And maybe I need to find a way to make it clearer. I may slightly alter the design. But if you draw her, this is the thing that I would say. When you draw Badger Chan's face, I'm going to fill this with white so that it's...
You need to draw a reference of her with a hood down.
Like with the hood pulled back? Well,
yeah, so we can see what her hairstyle
is. You got that right. I mean, it's a bob cut, basically. It's like a sloppy bob, but... Because I think I do have...
It's kind of like Ghost in the Shell, JJ.
Oh, not quite like that. Like that's where it's sort of longer towards the front.
Or the chick from Dominus Hank Police.
I suppose.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a relatively common sort of way of drawing, like, medium-length hair. But,
yeah.
Okay.
I like that hairstyle anyway. It's very good.
I'll show you what I mean. So when you... This is her face, and I know it's a little off. Just bear with me. All right. When you draw the hair, this is the one thing that I noticed that people miss, and I try to make it clear, but I think that most people do get it, though. But where the bangs are at, and you did this right, so I'm not tripping on that, but when you do the bangs, they're supposed to look like teeth.
Yeah.
So these two are here, and these two here, like this one and this one are longer, so that when the hood is on, it sits right here. You know? So that's that's mainly that's the main thing, and of course she has teeth too. But the bangs should look like teeth. From when the hood is pulled up. I do not have autism. What are you talking about? Yeah, I also want a Badger Chan hoodie. Not save. All right. So anyway. But yeah, you did it fine, so it looks good. Corvus. Anyway, I'm going to wrap up the stream. Unfortunately, Eduardo never came, and Sugar Tits never came. Although, in Australia, to be fair, it's super early, and she's probably asleep, so... But I'm going to let you guys go. Okay. Thanks for coming on, Ku and... Clam. And Corvus for... joining us on the stream. And we'll see you guys in 2 weeks. I hope you enjoyed the Badger Art stream. And have a good one.